Welcome back everyone to theCUBE here at the NYSC studio. This is theCUBE's East Coast hub, of course, localizing out all the action in New York. We have a whole team here. Of course, we got our Palo Alto hub connecting Wall Street with Silicon Valley. And of course, in Boston area, we have the Marlboro studio where Rob Strechay is with me. That's where his home base is. We got the three studios. Of course, we cover all the events. We were just at AWS this week. This is our media week here as part of theCUBE and the NYSC and our Wired community out there. So again, we're covering cloud and AI all day long until the turn off the lights. Rob, great to see you. I know you were banging the streets hard, pounding the pavement, doing a lot of briefings, getting the inside baseball at AWS Summit. You were pre-event at the analyst for event, deep in the weeds, talking to the leaders. What's the scoop?
Yeah, I think what was great with AWS this week was they brought together a lot of what was going on from an AI workflow perspective and all of the pieces and foundational pieces to that. A lot of that also had to do with many of their partners. There was a lot of activity around GSIs, a lot of their ISV partnerships that you've had on as well. And I think what's really been a lot of fun has been the fact that it's such a community event, and this event in general has grown so huge. Just tons of stuff. Really, I would say that how they were bringing together making agents easy was kind of the theme I came away with.
Yeah, what was the your takeaway on the MCP server debate? Not really debate, but it's clearly momentum. The organic rallying around that protocol has been, I mean, I think a smashing result of good community. Reminds me of the Kubernetes when they had to kind of get rally around Kubernetes, say, let's just cut the BS, let's get behind something.
Yeah.
But then you have all these MCP sprawls, right? And then now you got Amazon saying, let's tune these, make sure they're solid. It's not that it's not secure, it's just protocol.
Right.
Now, if it gets unsecure, it's because of other things. What's your, I mean, that's my take.
Yeah.
What's your take?
No, I think it's like Oprah. You get an MCP server. You get an MCP server. Everybody gets an MCP server. When you start to look at MCP sprawl.
People building their own.
Well, they are. And so it's almost bring your own MCP server, easy to say. But then you also had Swami up there talking about A to A. And I think it's not a either or type of thing. And I think Amazon realizes that. Google realizes it by donating A to A to the Linux community and to the Linux Foundation. And what you see is that Amazon is, you know, again, showing their open source chops by contributing to both projects. And I think that's going to be key to them long.
I saw Allison Wagenfeld from Google at Raise in Paris last week. Jim Zemlin was also there. So I had a nice little powwow with Allison. She mentioned, of course, she mentioned that they donated it. But then Swami's trying to take credit for it too. They're on the chair. So they're both kind of on the committee. But then what my congressman Jim Zemlin and the boat on the cruise was interesting. He's having a rationalization moment right now because, you know, he has both projects.
Right.
And he didn't say it was a problem. He's just saying, we'll see, but there's enough overlap, but they're not that the same. So he basically was trying to be political. On one hand, you can have MCP. On the other hand, you can have A2A. But then he just basically said to me, we might have another, and I'm paraphrasing, CNCF-like moment because there's so much action going on around the AI side of the moment in Linux that it might have enough gravity to feel like the CNCF, which was formed at a KubeCon when you had a zillion vendors, a zillion end users coming in.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you look...
What do you think about that?
Both are in the Linux Foundation, right? MCP is part of CNCF. You have Linux Foundation doing A to A now. I think that it's a good center of gravity for both of them. And I think to your point, I think they also have their PyTorch community as well, which has a center of gravity around AI. So I think what you could see to your point is an AI moment for the Linux Foundation around this, where you have a lot of things that are in CNCF that may not fit nicely into their model that may need to be shifted over. And I think there'll be some rationalization. They're smart people. And I think they're looking at it. I think to your point, I think MCP is really the protocol, and you start to look at it. Most people are, it's a way to communicate via APIs and basically publish subscribe. I mean, you know, we're old enough to remember publish subscribe and moments, and that's really what they're doing with this and having a way to discover tools that AI can go and use. And Bedrock is really looking to leverage that. I think you look at SageMaker and what they're doing, making Nova part of that as well, so that you can use that as part of a tool set as well. I think how LLMs get utilized and how different pieces are the MCP, then are the agents using A to A to talk and communicate as you get into these multi-agentic frameworks. A lot of pieces that are moving around.
Yeah, everyone's an AI company. I noticed that at the Raise conference. It's like, you know, PagerDuty's up there and they have AI, but like, no one goes on stage and says, I'm not an AI company. You can't say that. I'm old. You got to be relevant. And I was just talking with Mark Castleman earlier before you came on. Intel, he's a senior executive. He's seen a lot like you. He's looking at that, but he's not in the industry side, the analyst side like you are. You have to be an AI company or you're dead. So it's like AI washing is a reality because that's the new normal. But then again, there is real AI, then there's fake AI. So as you look at the industry, what's your takeaway for the impact of what Amazon just did and what's happening in the industry? Because it's going to impact people in a positive way. Some people maybe put their head in the sand and they ignore it. What's your feeling of the reality setting in inside other people in the ecosystem, other vendors?
Yeah, I think it's going to have a huge impact on how the data platform vendors are there. And if you think of them like the Snowflakes, the Databricks, even some of the Amazon, when you look at some of the Aurora Postgres stuff that they're doing, EDB, who's another open source Postgres on Kubernetes, I think a lot of these people are looking at how that they play in this new ecosystem where the framework of agentic is sitting above them and how tied in is it? And I think that goes back to Swami talking about, you know, AWS S3 buckets for vectors. And when you start to look at what vectors get tiered, now we're talking about tiering vectors, not just tiering storage and things like that. And I think the complication of bringing this all together is a perfect place for somebody like an Amazon. And but you have people like Databricks that have their stack, and you have Snowflake building their stack, and you have people on the other data platforms building their stacks, and other clouds in particular building their stacks.
Notice S3 vectors got kind of buried in the news.
They did
talk about it. I mean, even Kiro was pre-released the day before. It's almost like the throwaway news.
And SageMaker catalog, which was kind of redoing how their SageMaker is really subsuming some other technologies that they had in the catalog space. Yeah. Because when you look at it, and I look at where an analogy for me was vCenter with VMware. Yeah. Why did VMware really take off like a rocket? Because it became a center of gravity where people were really integrating into vCenter, and that became a control plane.
Yeah.
So to break away from that control plane, you had to do a lot. Nutanix did a ton in that space. Now you have people looking at the catalogs as that control space and really that metadata semantic layer inside the catalogs and across catalogs. Hence, you know, you've got people like Salesforce going and, you know, announcing their intentions to buy Informatica, and we'll see where that goes. But that's to unlock that walled garden to go cross catalog. And I think that's really where people are going to go.
So the data impact, you think that data, so storage and data platforms are probably going to be most impacted because of structural change and enablement?
Yes.
Or is that kind of the thought?
I think you're going to see things like data pipelines and Iceberg really changing storage into data platforms that they can then be leveraged by other parts of the data management stack, which I would put Spark and Databricks and Snowflake into, those compute engines. And then you start to look at how this all be brought together, and you'll have catalogs of catalogs and integrated or federated catalogs. Something is going to happen in that space. And then you have to have things like I said at the storage level, where S3 is going with their table buckets, where others like HPE, Dell, and on-prem crew, NetApp are going with their storage arrays. And
so really storage, networking, and compute vendors are going to be impacted.
Correct.
Cloud data center and semiconductors, certainly seeing SageMaker tuning.
Yes.
And then the database world's impacted. Security, not so much. No?
I think security is still a... it's one of those places where people have not figured it out yet.
I think it'll change, but I don't think it's going to be threatening to any companies.
I think you're right. I think it's an opportunity, not a threat.
I'm looking at who's going to die and who's going to win. Because right now, the things that I see, and I'd love to get your reaction to this, is that there are going to be winners and losers clearly in these ways. Because everyone is an AI company. That's a fact. If you believe that to be true, and it is true, everyone's saying they're an AI company because they have to. then not everyone is an AI. That's because that's true too, right? So there will be dead players coming. Yeah. Okay, so the question is, who's going to die? Vast Data, DDN, Oracle, HPE, NetApp, Dell, IBM, AWS, Weka, Supermicro, Hammerspace, Solidigm, Hitachi, Ventara, MinIO, Nutanix, Cisco, Juniper, Arista, and Extreme.
Yeah.
Of those lists, who dies?
I think in...
Maybe you don't answer that
question. I'm not going to answer it specifically, but I think that out of the storage layer, the ones who don't evolve from being storage to being a data platform and having true data platform capabilities and don't come closer to the compute layer are really going to suffer, and they're going to just fade away. They'll have their because you still have your traditional ML and other applications in HPC, which maybe they can do just fine in that. But if you don't come up the stack and get to the metadata layer where you're, you know, and open table formats, you're going to have a tough time.
Yeah.
I think those who...
So those are real changes that are going to impact everyone out of the gate.
Yeah. And the self-configuring, I mean, still the last mile, the being able to go fast is constrained by networking. So I think that, you know, talking to Bob Liberté on the team here, you know, when we talk about AI for networking and networking for AI, there's definitely a transition there. And a lot of it is, you know, how do you use AI to manage it and make it easier? But at the same time, you need to be able to have DPUs and things of that nature, which the cards in there, the network cards that help you categorize all the data. So
on
a lot
of on the cloud data center and semi side, I think that's more of a who can enable their services in a way or can have it configured. Because one of the things that came out of AWS from my interviews yesterday and today was Amazon's pretty much got everything.
Yeah.
It's how you turn it on and how you want to, what you want to light up. I'll take some of that and then just do it. The startup that came in earlier, they're like, hey, I have OpenSearch, but I might just use their stuff. It's better. So it's like, okay, you can just turn it on. So I think that system view of a platform inside AWS is interesting. What, I mean, what's your take?
Yeah, I think it is. And I think to your point, I think AWS has taken a different approach to how they look at AI. And I think it becomes because it's, you know, what Bezos laid out forever ago, with the everything store. And being the everything marketplace and the everything data center is what they're really, and everything cloud is what they're really aiming at doing, is giving that functionality so you can build better on top of them. Now, I think there's others, like you have Microsoft and Google and Oracle, all doing very sometimes bespoke stuff, but also providing some other abilities outside of their stuff. Like Amazon, you know, okay, Nova, you don't want to use Nova, which is Amazon's, go and use Anthropic, go and use Claude, go and use some of these other things that are out there, and you can use them over MCP, you can use them over, you know, just the straight APIs. They're really focused on that diversity. I think where they have, and they've embraced the APN network that they have, is really focusing on a lot of the GSIs and the community around that that can help them. I met with Accenture, TCS, you had, forgetting one, Deloitte, and I saw video. I went and dove deep into a lot of what they're doing, and in many ways, they're looking and bringing to that model that their marketplace, they model the agent marketplace. They're bringing agent frameworks there, and what they're trying to do is help people, especially at these uber large companies, get to from, you know, that POC, you know, paralysis to get to production. How do you get out of paralysis and get to production? And what they're saying is, hey, instead of 8 months, let's get you there in 8 weeks and things of that nature. And that was talking to the folks at Accenture. Deloitte had a similar, had different, two different platforms that they were aiming for. Zora being one of them, it was a SaaS delivered platform that they were looking to also, but it was more templated. So you can also think down market. And where they're going to be strong is where they understand workflows. And I think this was the big piece that came out of this, is nobody's got the process focus nailed down yet in all of these places. And we talk to people like our friends over in Germany that, you know,
Solonis,
when we're talking with them about how do you do process mapping, and they have a lot of the GSIs that use them and things of this nature. So I think there's a lot to still be done. We're early innings. Big time, and the actual gap in people who know how to do stuff is really probably our number one impediment.
Yeah, it's hard. The consensus is hard to do agent. It looks easy on paper.
Yes.
In fact, Kalent was telling us they're seeing a lot of database migrations. So it's also a side effect of this agent momentum is, let's get our databases ported over and or moved off of X to Y. So are you seeing similar action around migrations to, yeah, for readiness, preparedness? It's like, get ready for the earthquake.
I think you can just look at it. One of the announcements where AWS talked about AWS Transform, which they had announced previously, but where they're using AI to move off mainframes. And yeah, this is all the way down into the database level and how you do those database migrations, where the GSIs, maybe they can do a part of it and the GSIs leverage that, but they also have some magic on top of that. I was talking to Deloitte about how they go about this. It's still not easy, and especially you want to get your data in order before you do AI, because once you, yeah, once you've plumbed it, you're kind of screwed.
Yeah, you got to get your shit together.
I know that's a technical term.
Yeah, and you got to get your shit together, and you can squeak, you can swear in the cube.
Exactly.
They got to get their act together. Rob, always great to have you on again.
Thank you.
I know you work really hard at getting the data, just getting the word out, looking forward to following up on more content. And then just, we start to turn the studio on here. Love the calls out here on the option floor.
I know, I love the energy. The energy is fantastic.
It's like a luxury box for the option floor.
Yes,
like, it's really beautiful. It's like, I feel like I'm at the game. Go Red Sox.
Yes, exactly. Go Sox.
All right, thanks for coming on.
I know the Yankees are up the street.
It's okay. It's okay. I saw some Trump fans out on the floor.
The seven over to City Park, you know, City Field there.
I grew up in New Jersey as a Red Sox fan. I can handle the heat, and I'm proud and loud with Red Sox.
Go Sox.
All right, more action coming. We are at the NYSE Cube Studios. NYC Wired, bringing all the leaders together, part of our AWS Summit coverage. This is our portion where we expand the conversation around AI and those events. So thanks for watching.